Welcome to this video tutorial series on masks in PaintShop Pro. Masking can seem like a confusing or overwhelming topic, but once you go through a few examples, you'll see that they're really quite easy to understand and use. Before we get started, if you're watching this video on YouTube, you'll find a link in the description below that will take you to our tutorial page on Corel's Discovery Center. Here you can find a written copy of this tutorial, as well as links to the other videos in this series on masks. One way to think of a mask is with the analogy of painter's tape on a blank wall. The photo is the paint, and the tape applied to the wall prevents those areas from being painted with the photo. Or you can also think of masks like windows. The areas not being masked are the parts of the photo that show through, like a window lets light show through a wall. The bits that are masked are like the wall. Whatever is behind the wall can't be seen through the window. To demonstrate, I have this image open and I'll choose Layers, Load Save Mask, Load Mask from Disk. I'll click this default mask and choose another one that's more obvious to see, the flower. The black areas will end up covering the image. Remember, black equals block. And the white areas will allow the image to show through, like a flower-shaped window. I'll keep the default settings, and I'll be covering these options later in the video series. I'll click Load. This is the result. The center of the photo appears, and the background is blocked off, following the flower shape. So, for a photo that has its subject in the center, this mask is good for blocking parts of the background and highlighting the subject. Also note the change of layer structure. The mask layer appears above the background layer, and both layers are placed inside a layer group. Masks are always grouped with the layer that was active when the mask was created. And because there's no practical reason for a mask to be under the photo, I can't drag this layer below the background. Masks can also have shades of gray, enabling some of the image to show through. I'll undo the flower mask, and I'm back to a single layer again, no groups. This time, I'll choose a different mask, the one called Edge Burst. It's white in the center and black and gray along the edges. The result is that I can see the entire image in the center, and there's some partial transparency outside this area. There are several practical uses for masks. I'll demonstrate some quick examples in this video, and I'll go through examples in more detail in later videos in this series. For my first example, I'll first remove the Edge Burst mask. Then I'll add a new raster layer above the photo and use Flood Fill to paint the entire layer green. The green layer is active, so whatever mask I add now will be applied to the green and not to the photo. And this time I want to block the center of the green layer, not the parts along the edges. So when I go to apply the mask, this time I'll invert the transparency so that the center will be black and therefore blocked. The green layer remains atop the image as a frame, with some translucent areas, and the center of the image shows through. And because the green layer was active when I applied the mask, the green layer and mask are grouped. I can turn off the entire group to remove the green frame, or I can just remove the mask to bring back the full green layer. We saw that PaintShop Pro comes with a few mask images, and in a later video I'll show how to get more from Corel's Discovery Center. But a mask can also be an image you create or find yourself. I'll remove the mask and the green layer from this photo. Then I'll open this image that I found online, which is black in the center and has a square shape. And keep in mind, you can use a color image as a mask as well, though PaintShop Pro will reduce it to grayscale when used for masking. I'll switch to Window, Tile Vertically to see both images. Going back to my photo, this time I'll choose Layer, New Mask Layer, From Image. I'll find the image from this list, and I'll invert it so that black and white will be switched, meaning the outside will be blocked and not the center. And note that the mask image was stretched to fit this photo, which is one of the default mask settings. To get the same green frame effect I got before, I can just create a new layer, flood fill it green, and drag it below the mask group. The green fills in all the black and gray parts of the inverted mask. I'll right-click on this group to ungroup the layers, then delete the mask, choosing not to merge the mask when deleting. I'll keep the green-filled layer below, and my photo layer is active. The Layers palette also has masking options. If I click the New Mask Layer icon, I have the From Image option, as well as Hide All and Show All. I'll show these more in depth in later videos, but basically these options enable you to either hide or block the entire image and use white paint to bring back the parts you want to show, or I can show the entire image and use black paint to define the areas to block. I can also use masks for transitions between images. I have these two images open, one as a photo, and the other is the photo with the stained glass effect applied from our Pick to Painting plugin. In the painted image, I'll add a new mask layer. Either show or hide will work. On this mask layer, I'll add a black to white gradient fill I created for this purpose and flood fill it in. Then I can select the regular image and copy it. Going back to the masked image, I'll paste in the photo and drag its layer to the bottom. This creates a smooth and gradual transition from one image to the other. I can do the same thing with this panorama, transitioning from grayscale to color. Another use for masks is to make textures. In this example, I have a new image with two raster layers, each flood-filled with two shades of blue. I can turn off the darker layer to see the lighter one below. I also have open this grayscale image of wood grain. With the darker blue layer active, I'll apply this mask, which creates an image that looks like distressed wood painted blue. I can make the mask group active and reduce its opacity to bring out more of the light blue below. I'll close the wood grain image, and I'll keep this one open to use later. Finally, I'll show one more mask scenario for making a collage. I'll choose File, New from Template, choose the Collage category, and select this free template called Shatter 01. The layer structure of this template contains four groups, one for each photo slot, each group containing a mask above a dark gray placeholder shape. Each group's mask is all black with a white shape in various locations to correspond with the transparent cutout in the template itself. And of course, the white spot is where the collage photo will go. I have the photos I want to include open over here. For the first image that's to go into the collage, I'll make it active and copy it. Then I'll go back to my collage, choose the layer where I want this photo to go, and paste it. Then, with the new photo layer active, I'll use the Pick tool to move and size the photo to fit its spot. What's great about this is that no matter what the size of the photo, no photo will ever appear in any spot but its own masked shape. Without masks, it would be really tough to fit these photos into such irregular shapes. I'll repeat these steps for the remaining photos. I still have my masked wood texture open here, so let's make use of it. I'm not so sure blue wood is what I want, but I can flood fill both layers with other colors, such as two shades of brown. The masked grain pattern remains. I'll merge all layers to a single layer, and I'll copy this image. On my collage, I'll activate the template layer and use the background eraser with a huge brush to erase the white background. I'll copy and paste in the wood, drag its layer to the very bottom, and use the Pick tool to size the wood to fit the background. I'll demonstrate more about collages later in this series. This brings us to the end of this introduction to masks. The next video in the series will cover several ways to create masks, including masks you can create yourself. If you've been watching this video on YouTube, please follow the link in the description below, which will take you to this tutorial page in Corel's Discovery Center. Here you'll find a written version of this tutorial, along with links to the other videos in this series on masks.